this morning is from Luke 4, verses 1 to 19, and I'm reading to you from the NIV translation. Jesus, the Son of God, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He had nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. And the devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone." The devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all the authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give you leading to Jerusalem, and I will stand on the highest point of the temple. If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guide you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against the stone." Jesus answered, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to test." When the devil had finished all his thinking, he left him until the opportune time. Jesus then returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and the news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in the synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, church. How are you all doing this morning? Holding on. It's always a great privilege for me to be able to have an opportunity to share God's word. And I know it feels like a mere formality, but perhaps it's more for myself to remain grounded. I take this task very seriously. And on Sundays like these, when I think about the fact that the Spirit of God is in this place, I think Mr. Yaku said that I'm in the presence of other believers, and it's like, worship God, and I'm like, "Look, my Lord, you're here." So to come up and then to be the one who has the privilege of sharing God's word, it's not something I take lightly. My name is Mother Lumi. I'm sorry I have the privilege of sharing God's word with you this morning. We're coming today to a series called "That's Great News." Last week we looked at the perfect birth of Jesus. Today we're looking at the perfect life of Jesus. You have heard Josie speaking earlier on as he's talking about the fact that we're gospel-centered disciple-making, cross-cultural church, and the gospel-centered mindset. We believe in our lives centered and saturated around the truth of the perfect birth, life, death, resurrection, ascension, and return of Jesus, affirming him as Lord and Savior. So today, we're looking at the perfect birth, the perfect life. We're looking at the perfect life as characterized by Jesus' holiness and his love. So the title of our message is "A Holy and Loving Jesus." A holy and loving Jesus. And these are the 4 points we'll be walking through this morning. Firstly, Jesus lived a holy life. Secondly, Jesus lived a loving life. Thirdly, you can live like Jesus, and we'll conclude with the fact that you can turn to Jesus. So the first 2 points we'll be looking at: the life of Jesus, his holiness, his having made some left-back moves within the context of the perfect pass, and then we'll conclude this learning with 2 points. What does that mean for us? We're going to talk about this after the ability to live like Jesus, and conclude with the encouraging truth that we can change Jesus. Let me pray for us this morning. Heavenly Father, we come to this story, we thank you that you are a blessing God. We thank you that you are a holy God. We thank you for your perfect life. This morning, Lord Jesus, I pray that you may be with each one of us, Lord. Speak through me this morning, Lord God, may you speak to your people this morning, Heavenly Father. Let us know what you want us to hear. Be with us this morning, Father. Will you continue to move among us this morning, Lord Jesus? Let us turn to you now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The perfect life of Jesus is great news. The gospel of Jesus is great news. Being a Christian, being a true follower of Jesus, is being part of great news. No matter what is going on in your life, we are part of great news. We experience great news. We love great news. We share great news. We can never be lost on us. No matter what you're going through, Matthew 11:28, Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. That's great news. This week, we look at the great news of the gospel of Jesus through his perfect life. We'll be specifically looking at our teaching text this morning and how we experience the perfect life of Jesus. And so, to get straight into our first point then, we say, Jesus lived a holy life. You see, it matters that Jesus lived a holy life. In the biblical text, the Greek word for holiness is hagios, which means to be set apart by God, to be set apart for God, to be sanctified, to be made holy. In contrast, the Greek word for sin is hamartia, which means to miss the mark, to stray from the things of God. And in our text, Satan tried to get Jesus to stray from the things of God. Satan tried to get Jesus to fall to temptation. Praise God, he didn't. And by the way, when you say matters that Jesus lived a holy life, if you think about the question, if Jesus didn't live a holy life, would there be implications? There's a reason Satan did what he did to attempt to bring Jesus down, because it matters, church, that Jesus lived in a holy life, that he was a holy God. There are theological thoughts out there that make people say, yeah, no, it's okay if God is not perfect. It's okay if God could make mistakes. And I know, but theologically, surely that doesn't make sense. It matters that Jesus lived a holy life. So in our teaching text, we'll see in verses 3, verses 7, and verses 9, you see Satan attempting to take Jesus. In verse 3, Satan says to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, turn the stone to bread. He goes on to say in verse 7, I will give you everything that is in front of you, for I have been given authority to have access to this. And if you worship me, I will give it to you. In verse 9, Satan again questions the identity of Jesus. He says, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself off of this mountain. Remember that prior to Luke chapter 4 and Luke chapter 3, Jesus had just gotten baptized. So do you remember what happened? The Bible says the heavens opened up, the Spirit of the Lord descended on him, and what did God say? This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. God confirmed Jesus' identity at that moment. And literally with a chapter, what does Satan do? He tries to question and challenge the identity of Jesus. He tries to challenge it. As he's trying to challenge us now. This is great news, church. Jesus, though knowing his own identity, is able to stand firm. Look at
Look at verses 4, verses 8, and verses 12. What does Jesus say? It is written. And Satan, don't try and confuse me, because I know what the Bible says. I know what God says about you. And then he goes on to say what is actually written. He says, man shall not live on bread alone. In verse 4. Verse 8. Worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Verse 12. Do not put the Lord your God to this. One of the things I want us to be encouraged by this morning, church, is the fact that the holy life that Jesus lived is not the supernatural life that is not attainable. The things that Jesus did, you and I can do. So, the Bible doesn't tell us that Jesus called all the angels from heaven and said, help me now to overcome Satan. Jesus, dare I say it, simply quoted Scripture. Scripture that you and I have access to. Jesus stood firm in the face of trial, in the face of temptation. Jesus lived the Holy Land. Because it matters that Jesus lived the Holy Land. You see, because you are then able to take the qualified position of being a satisfactory sacrifice. The word that they say was a propitiatory sacrifice. Because you are sinless, because you live the holy life. Look at these verses with me that talk about the holiness of Jesus' life, the sinlessness. 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. 1 John 3 verse 5, but you know that he appeared at so that he might take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. Hebrews 4:15, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we were, yet he did not sin. 1 Peter 2 verse 21 to 22, to this you are called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found. Jesus lived a sinless life. But it seems that he lived a holy life because he lived a sinless life. As you look at Luke chapter 4, as you see verses 1 and 2 in our teaching text, this was the early, what they call the early stages of Jesus' public ministry. And like I said, he had just been baptized. And once being baptized, receiving the Holy Spirit, he was able to go out and minister accordingly. But as you see in the text, Jesus then sets the tone for how he was going to live his life. He sets the tone for us. And what is that tone? That he trusted God. He lived in fear and reverence of God. That he had a close relationship with God. That he lived a life led by the Spirit. That he lived a life founded on the Word. And look at verses 1 and 2. What does the Bible say? Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them he was hungry. In the final passage in Matthew, it says Jesus fasted for 40 days. And the process of fasting is you sacrifice food, you sacrifice sustenance, that which you need to literally live. Early on in Jesus' ministry, he starts off by saying, yeah, God, at the same time with you and your will. And so we see he fostered a close relationship with God. He feared and revered God as well. And he was led by the Spirit. You see, the man you see in Luke chapter 4, church, in all the Gospels, is a man who was a product of years of choice. Consistency in the right practices. Jesus wasn't the success overnight. I guess maybe you are because it's Jesus. But the success within the context of having the fortitude, having walked with Jesus, having walked with God for years. I mentioned a couple of studies ago that this year,
committed my life to Jesus when I was 16 years old. So I've been walking and tasting with Jesus for 20 years. By the grace of God. So crazy when I think about it. When I look at the young man I was in 2002, and I look at the man that I am now in 2023, and I can encounter various challenges in life very differently to where I was 20 years ago. But the things that came with time. I know the scriptures the way I do now because over 20 years is very intentionality in reading the scriptures, in talking to God, in praying. Jesus was a doctor of years of consistency. In Luke chapter 2, a few chapters back from our teaching text, we see the Bible tells us that Jesus, that his mother and his father had taken him to the temple. Year in, year out, he was in the temple. Luke chapter 2 tells us that he was going back and forth with the religious leaders about the text. And he continued for years to learn the text. In Luke 4, when you see Jesus quoting scripture, being able to discern when Satan is twisting the truth of God. Because by the way, you see that Satan actually quoted scripture to Jesus. He didn't just randomly make statements. He told the Bible, presented the Bible to Jesus. But because Jesus had been walking with God for years and he knew the scriptures intimately and the truth about the scriptures, he was able to say, "You're trusting the scriptures." You remember what happened to Adam and Eve? Did God really say? Questions what God said to us. Jesus lived a holy life in an attainable manner. I want us to be encouraged this morning to know that we can live the life of Jesus. And he did it in three ways. For those who are those three guys, there are three ways that Jesus accomplished a holy, sinless life. One, he stayed close to God. Two, he was led by the Holy Spirit. Three, he was grounded in God's word. So in Luke chapter 4, verse 2, I already mentioned to you that he had practices in place where he stayed close to God. When he prayed, he fasted. Consistently so. In Luke chapter 5, verse 16, and in Mark chapter 1, verse 35, the scripture tells us that Jesus often withdrew to lonely places to pray. Church, may we not lose sight of the fact that when Jesus showed up in the communities, he showed up from a place of overflow. He had spent time with his Father, and thus he walked out in confidence. So he stayed close to God. Second one, as I said, he was led by the Spirit of God. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, Paul teaches us that the Spirit and the flesh are literally at war. The flesh says, "I want you to conform to the desires of my lust and flesh." The Spirit says, "I want you to live a life that honors God." And so he says, be led by the Spirit. So, Jesus, when he's led by the Spirit, it's living a life that God designed for his children. To be led by the Spirit and not ourselves and not the lust of the flesh. And then lastly, grounded in his word. Luke 4, verses 4, verses 8, verses 12. The first thing he said was that response. So this is good news to us. That Jesus did live a holy life. So our first point is merely to remind us, to show us in scripture, how Jesus lived a holy life. How it may restore Jesus to his sinners. Second point this morning is Jesus lived a loving life. Matthew 22, verse 37 to 14, the Bible tells us that the religious leaders tried to test Jesus. They asked him, "What's the greatest commandment?" Thinking, the Bible is so vast that the Old Testament scriptures are so vast that there's no way they identify one scripture. Then the wisdom of God. Jesus said, the scriptures are summed up in two verses. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. He says, all the law and the prophets hang on these two. Jesus loved God, his Father. And by the way, you see this at the first point. A life of holiness to his Maker wasn't an expression of
overflow of his love. So my faithfulness to my wife is a confirmation of my love for her. Right? I treat myself still for her. That is an act of my love. My love for God is to honor that I must remain faithful to God. So when Jesus remains faithful to his God, it's an expression of his love for his God. And that's what it is. If you love God, if you love me, you will follow my commands, Jesus says. And now we see that Jesus can equally love his people. The great commandment is love God and love others. In Luke chapter 4, teaching us what we'll see, I started by telling us that Jesus goes around teaching in the synagogues. God's desire, Jesus' desire for us to know the truth is part of his work for us. He doesn't want us to walk in deception. He wants us to walk in truth. His truth, that's part of his love for us. So the Bible tells us in verse 15 that he moved around teaching in the synagogues. And he goes in verses 18 to 19 and says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. He has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and the recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Again, Jesus set the tone of how he was going to live his life. If you look at verses 18 and 19, it speaks about the things Jesus would do, that God would do through Jesus for the oppressed. And the entirety of Jesus' life then was filled with that, with examples of that, as we'll walk through a little bit later in the message. See, in Luke chapter 4, verse 18 and 19, Jesus laid the foundation for how he would live his life, and ultimately how we should live our lives. Jesus loved his people. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, it's a scripture where the Bible talks about how wives should conduct themselves with their husbands and husbands should conduct themselves with their wives. And in verse 25 of Ephesians chapter 5, it says, husbands, love your wives like Christ loved the church. And he gave himself up for them. Sacrificed his life as a confirmation of his love for Christ's church. Jesus loved us. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. God said, I love the world, and therefore I gave my one and only son. See, loving others means you sacrifice. Loving others means you sacrifice. You give up your own desires. You give up stuff for others. And that's what you think, you can't have nice things, by the way. There are Christians that teach you, or there's a Christian you must never have nice things. That's what you say that. Simply to say, you don't just think about your nice things. Think about other people having nice things. It says, love your wives as the way you love yourself. So the things we would do for ourselves, and that's the thing about the church. If we think about the truth about the church, the things I'm willing to do for my wife, I must be willing to do for my brothers and sisters in Christ. By the way, there's a sermon for another day. I won't get into that. It's Christianity being church. It's not for children who want to play games. Serious. It's great news. It's important. There's a verse that I love, and I think we have it, that captures this essence of love and loving people and loving others. 1 John 3, verse 16 to 18. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, that's not love with words or speech, but with actions and truth. Do you hear those words? say, how do you see, how do I see Seattle? And I always think Seattle is a new town. It's not that I like seeing Montgomery and Austin in church, but I see Seattle right here. How do I see Seattle needing God loves you, he's going to bless you, I will pray for you. Oh yeah. And then I'll take my bread and I walk past him and I'll put it in there. Listen to what Jesus is saying. How do you see a brother or sister who needs material possessions and you have them and you don't give it to them? How can you dare say the love of God is in you?
Don't say that, listen.
The Bible talks about love, so it is a profound truth that calls us to action. And then you see what it concludes by saying, dear children, let's not just love with words and with speech. Let's love with actions and in truth. So I say all of these things because when you look at the life of Jesus, this is what he did. Don't serve a God who talks the talk and doesn't walk the walk. Because you see the rest of Jesus' life. Anyone in his ministry looks at the 4 verses 18 and 19 and says, he preached these beautiful words. He said, he was the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and to tell you a sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then, humanity waited to see what he would do with his life. It didn't just say, with those eloquent words.
He went on to Bethlehem, to Bethlehem, to confirm it, literally day after day after day.
When you look at Jesus' life and how he lived his life, and how he gives his actions towards others go,
you see the love that he had for his people, the love he had for humanity.
Word compassion. Because I think sometimes love is so broad that we can get lost in what love actually is. Compassion speaks to a serious family need and a need for bread. And by the way, family, I talk about my family
is not bread right now as we speak. I'm just giving an example.
So you say a serious family is bread. I know in my head that it's a sad reality. But with compassion, it says, this feeling and this emotion that students are spending with their feeling and emotion are moved to action. And check this out, I'm going to show you something very cool. I'm going to walk you through a couple of scripture examples of the words compassion linked with the actions of Jesus. In Matthew chapter 9, verse 36, Jesus goes into the crowd and says he heals, he preaches, he casts out demons. And then he goes on to say, Matthew 9, 36, when he saw the crowd, he felt compassion for them because they were distressed and dejected, like sheep without a shepherd. He moved in their lives. He was moved with compassion. Matthew 14, 14, when Jesus went and saw, he saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them, and he healed the sick. Matthew 15, 32, Jesus called his disciples and said, I have compassion on the crowd, because they've already stayed with me for 3 days and had nothing to eat. I don't want to send them away hungry, otherwise they might collapse along the way. He goes on to feed them. Matthew 18, 27, then the master of the servants had compassion, released him and forgave his loan. Speaking about the master, he sent to God and his children and his people. Luke 7, verse 13, when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and he said, don't weep, don't cry. And he came up and touched the open coffin, and the pallbearer stopped, and he said, young man, I tell you to get up. He resurrected her and brought her his son. Good day. Luke 15:20 says he got up and went to his father, but while the son was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran and threw his arms around his neck and kissed him. This is the parable of the prodigal son. He looked closely at the life of Jesus. And he talks about loving his people. You don't need to see him loving his people. You just need to see his actions. Because he confirms his love for his people in what he does. Jesus' interactions and actions towards his people are always from a place of love and compassion. Open your Bibles with me. So if you have your Bibles, please hold them. If you have them on your phone, please take out your phone. You're going to use one button, which is a skip to the next chapter button. So we're going to look at Luke chapter 4, and we're going to move across the chapters sort of consecutively, right? Have a look at this with me. Look at what Jesus tells us. Luke chapter 4, right? So it tells us that starts with Jesus feeding the man. So I want you to look at the headings, if you can. In the Bible app, it might be just scroll a little bit, but take a look at the headings. So, in Luke chapter 4, we see one of the headings is Jesus heals the man. In Luke chapter 5, we see the heading that Jesus heals the paralytic. In Luke chapter 6, we see that Jesus teaches the truth. In Luke chapter 7, we see that Jesus raises the widow's son. In Luke chapter 8, we see that Jesus heals the demon-possessed man. Luke chapter 8, we see that Jesus raises a dead girl. Luke chapter 8, we see that Jesus heals a sick woman. Woman with a bleeding issue for 12 years. Luke chapter 9, we see that Jesus feeds the 5,000. Luke chapter 10, to the subsequent chapters, he continues to teach the truth. He sends out his disciples, showing his relationship with them. He loves the little children. The disciples want him to push the children away, says, bring the little children, that they bless them, for God loves the little children. And ultimately, concluding each gospel by giving up his life. You did that in a short couple of seconds. You look at the entire scripture, you see God moving in people's lives. His movements, his actions are confirmation of his love. Yeah. Time runs away when you're preaching sometimes. Time is running away, but it's okay. You're still hearing it. You're still hearing God's word. You're still finding points, I'll go through them quick. But our first 2 points, again, we see the perfect life of Jesus characterized by his holiness and by his love. Now in the last 2 points, we're going to look at what does it mean for us. So firstly, it means we can live like Jesus. John 14 verse 12, I'm not sure if you have it. That's wonderful, thank you, Rudolph. It says, very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father. He will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father. So, I'm a big sports fan. I watch a lot of sports. And when I thought about this verse, I thought to myself, it's almost like some of my favorite athletes telling me, so the question, to answer my question for what talent do I choose in athletic ability? My athletic ability is average right now. But it's like every divinity coming to me and telling me, more than you can bet like Andrew. You can feel like Andrew. It's like Brian Havana telling me, Emma, you can step the fingers like Andrew. You can jump over the timeline like Andrew. It's like Lionel Messi telling me, you can bend that few kick and put him in the top corner like I do. It's like Stephen Curry telling me that you can hit the handles that I do and shoot the three pointers like I do. If those individuals said that to me, I'd say, yo, this is amazing. Me, what I did, I can look like you.
And yet Jesus says, Jesus, the Son of God, lived this amazing life, and you indeed can look like me. You can do the things that I did, and in fact, you can do greater things. Jesus and his role and his humanity
Sometimes it is. When we say this is great news, we're not saying this is great news that our favorite artist is in town and we can go and see them perform. When we say great news, the news about the gospel of Jesus and the transforming power of Jesus, it's great. There are no greater news than those news. No greater news. So when Jesus told us we can live like him, that's a truth of encouragement. And remember, Jesus lived an attainable life. And this is three things and three ways in which Jesus lived a holy and ultimately loving life. Stay close to him. He was led by the Holy Spirit. He was grounded in the Word of God. Those are things that I can do. Those are things that you can do. The Bible tells us that Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit and that he lived his public ministry. The Bible tells us that when we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, the Spirit of God comes into us. And you'll notice in John 14, verse 12, Jesus says you can do these things and greater things because I go to the Father. You understand? We have access to the things that Jesus had in order to accomplish the things that he accomplished. The Spirit of the Lord is in us. Jesus himself is in us.
trail has been, it's been a hard year for my life, right? Despite the blessings that we had, we're expecting our first son, praise the Lord. But it's been a hard one.